Hello and welcome to NPTEL MOOC on Applied Electromagnetics for Engineers. In this module, we consider the quasi-static analysis of skin effect in a round wire of radius A. We have already set up the preliminary problem statement in the previous module, so please refer to that one. We have a wire of radius A, which of course carries a current J. Okay. We have not discussed the fields inside a wire, we will leave that one for some other module to do so. But our goal would be to see whether we are able to obtain the expression for the surface impedance ZS that we obtained for the case of a plane wave. And if we obtain that, what about the values of R int and L int? Whether those values will go to the familiar values or they will in the limit go to the familiar values when the frequency is made to 0. So that is the question that we are trying to answer. And to do so, we actually construct two loops. Okay. So I have a loop which is, you know, some length L long, and this loop is cutting a constant value of phi. So this is a constant phi loop. Let us label this loop as A, B, C, D. Okay. And then we go along this particular loop in this manner that we have taken. Of course, because of the current that is flowing through the wire, there will be magnetic field, and the magnetic field will form these circles at a constant radius R. So if you consider the radius R, so I am considering that this is, you know, 0, and this loop occupies from R to R equal to A. Okay. So the magnetic field of course will be coming out in this way, it is in the phi direction, and it will have a constant value when it is at a constant radius R around the axis of the loop. That's essentially what you would expect from Ampere's law. Okay. We will of course neglect displacement current because this is a good conductor, therefore omega epsilon is extremely small compared to sigma. Okay. So this is how the magnetic fields are coming out, coming around this one. So if I consider applying Faraday's law to this one, that is evaluate integral of E dot dl over the loop, that must be equal to minus mu dh by dt over the surface that you obtain by looking at the area formed by this particular loop. Since we know that the electric field is along the z axis, because the wire is assumed to be along the z axis, the current is flowing along the z axis. So the when you apply this one over the loop, what you obtain is Ez of A, where Ez, the subscript Z, tells you that the electric field is along the Z axis and the value here is at A. So Ez of A times L minus Ez of R times L. Obviously these segments BC or DA do not contribute to any EMF because electric field is perpendicular to those cases. This must be equal to, what is the surface area of this one? This would be some value L because this is along the Z axis, but now you have an integration variable. The second integration variable is along R direction, and the field is in general not uniform. Therefore, you have integral of mu dH of R or dH phi of R, because H is along the phi direction, just to remind ourselves, and times dR dt, that is the changing magnetic flux or the flux associated with that one, is given by L, which is the integration over the Z axis that we have performed, whereas this integration is being performed from R equal to R to A. Okay. So this is the open surface which encloses the magnetic flux, time varying magnetic flux, that should be equal to the EMF induced around this particular loop. Okay. Now, I also want to consider a different loop this time. The different loop that I am going to consider will be centered at the axis, and it would go only to a distance of R. Okay, so this is the axis. So this loop that I consider will go only over a distance of R, that is from 0 to R. Let's mark this loop as some E, F, G, H. Okay, so you have to imagine that this is the loop, and this is how the magnet, so this is the axis of the wire, and I have considered the loop EFGH such that it is, you know, circulating in the circumferential this one for the axis of the wire. So this is the wire, and then this is at a radius of R, and of course the wire is assumed to be reasonably thick, having a radius A, so that this small value of R is actually inside the wire itself. Okay. So over that one, for that loop E, F, G, H, E, if I apply Ampere's law, what do I obtain? The magnetic field there will be constant because it is being calculated at a constant radius r. Therefore, H phi of r is a constant along that, and the loop has a circumference of 2 pi r, which simply comes out because this would be integration over d phi, correct? So this would be 2 pi r into H phi of r. This, however, must be equal to the total current that is enclosed by the loop EFGHA. What is the current enclosed by the loop? Well, you have to go to r dr d phi, correct? You have to go to r dr d phi and go over phi of 0 to 2 pi because you are enclosing it completely. And for r, the integration variable is from 0 to r. And then you have the current density will be along the z axis and it would be a function of r. Okay, so this is the expression. So what we have here is one law, which is the Faraday's law, which allows you to calculate what is the EMF change or EMF over the loop ABCDA, and then Ampere's law without the modification of Maxwell. There is no displacement current because this is a good conductor. Okay, I hope you understand these two equations. Now, these two equations don't really tell much about anything, you know, because, well, we can first of all simplify this equation, because the integration over phi will give you 2 pi, and that 2 pi can cancel out with this 2 pi on the left hand side. So you have a slightly simplified expression, which will be r h phi of r given by integral of 0 to r onto this one. Okay, so this is, and of course you can rewrite jz as sigma ez of r. Okay, but we don't really want to do that because we want to eventually find out the current density. So I only retain jz here and instead convert from the Faraday's law whatever ez that I have into jz divided by sigma. Okay, so I rewrite Faraday's law, so I retain the same law or the same form of jz in the Ampere's law, but Faraday's law I will modify. So I obtain jz of a minus jz of r to be equal to sigma times integral r to a mu. If you want, you can pull mu outside the integration, so you can have sigma mu, then d h phi of r divided by dt times dr. There's only one small change that we are going to now make. Okay, we will assume that all quantities in terms of time exhibit a sinusoidal time variation. So they all go as e to the power j omega t, or they essentially go as a cosine omega t, which means that d by dt will be replaced by j omega. Is that okay? So d by dt can be replaced by j omega. Therefore, in this equation, the equation on the right hand side, I can put j omega in place of d by dt and pull out this one, right? So if I do that, you now have j 0 z of a. This 0 simply indicates the amplitude of the cosine waveform or the complex exponential waveform. Okay, so this is just for our reference. So j o z of a minus j o z of r, this is equal to the right hand side of that expression, you know, where you had d h phi by dt will become j omega mu sigma. Integration will still remain r to a h o phi of r dr. And what will happen to the other expression which had the Ampere's law? That becomes r h o phi of r equal to integral 0 to r j o z of r dr. So there is one more r here. So let me rewrite this one. So j o z of r dr. Here is a small caution or a small kind of a clarification. I know technically that, you know, if I have a integration variable r here, I should not be using the same value of r inside. I should be using some dummy variable, maybe lambda, beta, delta, right? Some other dummy variable I should be using. But I hope that you don't get confused between the integration variable and the limits of integration, because otherwise to use multiple dummy variables will complicate the notation slightly. So I am assuming that you all are aware of the difference between the integration limit and the integration variable itself. Okay, with that small clarification, let us go back. Okay, so I have two equations now. What do I do with these two equations? Well, unfortunately, in these two equations, I don't know h o phi of r, I don't know J O Z of R. Both quantities are unknown to me. All I know is J is along Z, H is along phi, but I don't know how they are actually changing with respect to R. Okay, with respect to time I know, but with respect to R I don't know. So what I do is I differentiate both expressions with respect to R. The left hand side of the first equation is easier to differentiate because this first term will go away. So you have minus d j o of z of r divided by dr, that would be equal to j omega mu sigma, because in the right hand side r appears at the denominator, there will be a minus sign further here, times h o phi of r. Okay, in fact this equation can be turned around to write h o phi of r as 1 by j omega mu sigma d j o z of r divided by dr. Okay, so I hope that this is visible for you. I have just inverted this one. The minus signs on both sides will cancel with respect to each other. So you have j omega mu sigma h o phi of r. What about the second equation? Well, the second equation, if you differentiate, you will have r d h o phi of r divided by dr, because I am differentiating the magnetic field component, plus h o phi of r. I don't have to differentiate this r, and I already know what is h o phi of r. H o phi of r can be obtained from this expression. So I can replace this one by 1 by j omega mu sigma dj by dr. This right hand side will of course, you know, will be equal to small r j o z of r. Okay, the only quantity that now is remaining is this expression d h o phi of r, but we can, you know, overcome that one by differentiating this expression once more. The expression for the surface current, if I differentiate it once more and substitute for h o phi and substitute for d h o phi of r by dr from this expression. So these two you have to substitute and carry out a little bit of an algebra. I won't go into the details of the algebra, they are not very difficult. You end up with a second order differential equation for the surface, for the current density vector j o z, as d square j o z by dr square will be equal to j omega mu sigma j o z of r minus 1 by r d j o z of r divided by dr. Okay, leave it as a small exercise. You can of course pull these quantities to the left hand side, so you don't need to keep them in the right hand side. So pull them into the left hand side and rearrange the equation, okay, so that you get plus 1 by r d j o z of r divided by dr minus j omega mu sigma j o z of r equal to 0. This is a very important equation, okay, for this problem that we have derived, and I will show the importance by simply writing a block. Now here is a problem. What is the solution of this equation? If you have taken courses on differential equations, you would recognize, or at least now that I have told you, you would go back and verify that this is actually a Bessel function. Bessel function equation of order 0. What is the Bessel function of general equation? You have, suppose f of r as a Bessel, as a function, unknown function f of r, then the Bessel equation, Bessel differential equation of order n, okay, is given by d square f by dr square plus 1 by r df by dr plus some h square, h is a constant, minus n square by r square times f equal to 0. Of course, in these equations, f is a function of r. Now you look at one by one terms, they all match. F is the same as joz, 1 by r df by dr also matches. Here you don't have any term which has some n square by r square, therefore n must be equal to 0 in this case. So when you map it to this one, you get n equal to 0, but then you have h square as a complex number, because h square is a complex number because h square is equal to minus j omega mu sigma, right? So I have h square equal to minus j omega mu sigma, and therefore h will be equal to square root of this. So minus j omega mu sigma, which can be written as 1 minus j divided by root 2 divided by or multiplied by square root of omega mu sigma. And you already know what is the square root of omega mu sigma. This would be 1 minus j divided by delta. Okay, well, although this we know, you have to actually know the solutions for the Bessel function. the correct Bessel function solution for this equation which we have written in this block, or we have emphasized with this block, is the Bessel function of order 0, argument being a complex number. The solutions for this equation, the red differential equation which is Bessel functions, is usually, unfortunately for you, is also denoted by the J, Bessel functions of the first kind and of order n and h times r, h being the constant. So unfortunately for you, the notation for Bessel function is the same as the notation for the current density. In order to, you know, avoid this problem of what we are talking of the current density or we are talking of the Bessel differential equation, we will go back to we will write a different notation. We will call this BE as the Bessel function. So this Bessel function, unfortunately, because h is complex, so you can clearly see h is complex, the solution must be broken up into real Bessel function and an imaginary Bessel function. These functions, you don't have to know them right now. You just take the solutions as what I am talking to you about it. You just take it on faith. But you can use MATLAB to plot real Bessel functions and imaginary Bessel functions, you know, for different values of h as a function of, sorry, for different values of r as a function of complex h or a h value out there. And when you do that, you will be able to visualize how the Bessel functions would look. Basically, Bessel functions have different kinds. So you have a first kind Bessel function which will be finite at r equal to 0, and you have a Bessel function of the second kind which will go off to infinity at r equal to 0. Because clearly I cannot have current density going to infinity at r equal to 0. R equal to 0 is the center of the wire. I have to choose as solutions the first kind of the Bessel function. So with all that said, the solution that I have for the current density, let me rewrite this one. This is the current density vector. For this current density vector, J of OZ of R is equal to some constant A0, which we still need to find out, and BE, you know, Bessel real function, square root of 2 by delta into R plus J, because the constant H turned out to be complex. So you will have real and imaginary Bessel functions. So this is the imaginary Bessel function, square root of 2 divided by delta times r. Okay. So this is the solution that we are looking for. Of course, I still don't know what is a0. Okay. There is one way I can find out a0, right? I can find out what is the total current enclosed. We will call this as I0, enclosed by this round wire. So that would be given by 2 pi 0 to a r j o z of r dr. That must be equal to the current enclosed. Unfortunately, this requires you to integrate Bessel functions, which is not at all simple. Okay, so we abandon this approach, which seems to cause more computations for us. Rather than that, we already know the relationship between h phi or h o phi times 2 pi a must be equal to the total current enclosed, which we will call as I0. Okay, so I0 is our total current, which then must be equal to HO phi evaluated on the edge of the loop or on the edge of the wire times 2 pi a, the circumference, that must be equal to I0. But what is the relationship between HO phi? This is proportional to DJOZ of R divided by DR. Evaluate this one at R equal to a. Furthermore, JOZ of a, that is the current density on the surface of the wire, can be written as a0, the real Bessel function, square root of 2 by delta a plus j, imaginary Bessel function, square root of 2 by delta a. Okay, and with this expression, I can replace a0 as joz of a divided by this term in the brackets. Okay, and consequently go back and substitute for a0 into this expression, obtaining the current density vector JOZ as JOZ of A. I still don't know what is the current density vector. I just know that this is a constant, right? Then I have BER P plus JBEI P divided by BER square root of 2 by delta A plus JBEI, the imaginary fellow, square root of 2 by delta times A, where P I have defined as square root of 2 by delta times R. Okay, that's just my notation. I could have defined this denominator as also some quantity Q. Okay, this is JOZ. You have to differentiate. So when you differentiate, you will obtain the differential of B Bessel real function and the differential of imaginary Bessel functions. Okay, so you will have BI, BEI prime, or you know, look at the relationship HO5 evaluated at A will be equal to 1 by J omega mu sigma D J O Z of R divided by DR at R equal to A. Okay, this must be equal to the total current I0 divided by 2 pi A. In fact, I can write I0, okay, after calculating the differential and rewriting all this, I can write I0 as 2 pi A square root of 2 divided by J omega mu sigma delta B E R prime of P plus J B E I prime of P divided by B E R P plus J B E I P. I will leave this as an exercise to you to note or to derive this one. So you can use these equations that I have written on the top and then substitute that one. The constant in the denominator will go away, therefore I did not want to write that constant again. So the constant has gone away and what you obtain is this expression which relates the current I0. Okay, you can further employ the relationship for delta, which is given by square root of 2 by omega mu sigma, into these expressions and write I0 as square root of 2 pi A J0 of A times delta, okay, these are some constants, times the imaginary component BEI prime P minus J BER prime P, okay, divided by BEI P minus J BER P. Why is there a minus sign here? Because there is a J in the denominator in this expression for I naught, and therefore when you go to that J expression, BEI prime will be positive, BEI P in the denominator will be positive. 1 by J when you take it to the numerator, that becomes minus J. So this is the expression for the current that we have obtained. Okay, so we have this current expression I0, but what is the quantity that we are interested in? The quantity that we are interested is in the surface impedance, right? The complex surface impedance is what we are interested. And this complex surface impedance is given by the electric field E0 divided by the total current enclosed. But since the current is related to the current density, this would be J0A or J0 of A divided by sigma I0, correct? Because current density and electric field are related. If you carry out this expression, or if you just do, you know, take the ratio of these two, what you get is a slightly lengthy expression, 1 by root 2 pi A delta sigma B E R P plus J B E I P divided by B E R prime of P minus J B E I of P. Okay, this of course can be rewritten in terms of R int plus J X int. This is a complex number, by the way, so you will have to multiply by the complex conjugate of the denominator and then adjust, or rather separate, the real and imaginary components. So you do all that. I will leave that as an exercise. Okay, so I will leave this as an exercise that you can show. The resistance, the internal resistance, is given by 1 by root 2 pi A delta sigma times some BER P BEI prime P minus BEI P. This expression is quite lengthy and you can't evaluate without some special numerical techniques for this, but luckily MATLAB and other programming languages do include the Bessel function, so you can go and substitute that for different values of P and then show that or plot what would be the internal resistance R int. In fact, remember, what is P? P is square root of 2 divided by delta into R, or in this particular case, because we have evaluated this one at R equal to A, everything is being evaluated at R equal to A. This would be square root of P by 2, square root of 2 by delta into A, right? So delta, you know, is given by 1 by, or rather square root of 2 by omega mu sigma. So therefore 1 by delta will be given as square root of omega mu sigma by square root of 2. There is a square root 2 in the numerator and A, that square root 2 will cancel, and P in this expression will be equal to omega mu sigma under root times A. So you can actually plot this for different values of A by delta, okay, or you can try to find out what will happen when omega is equal to 0. That is, when you take the limit of omega going to 0, you can find out what happens to the internal resistance as well as for the internal inductance. Okay, so if you evaluate this R int under the condition that omega tends to 0, you will actually see that this can be given by 1 by pi a square sigma, and 1 by pi a square sigma is nothing but 1 by area times sigma. This was precisely the resistance per unit length that we obtained in the previous module. Okay. Similarly, L int, which is the internal inductance, okay, obtained by looking at the reactance and dividing that one by the frequency of operation, under the condition that omega goes to 0. By the way, you have to find out this x int from the expression here, right? So there is an exercise which allows you to find this expression for x int and then divide that one by omega and then take the ratio of omega going to 0 and employ Bessel function tables. You can show that this should be equal to mu by 8 pi. I hope you are a little bit surprised in this case, or maybe you are not surprised because you have already seen this expression. This is the expression for the inductance, right? This is the precise expression for the inductance that we obtained for the core of a coaxial cable, and that is making a comeback over here, thus showing you that inductance concept that you normally define at DC or at the frequency omega equal to 0 is not quite the complete picture. The inductance is different as you go, or it becomes different as the frequency increases. The value that you calculate from that flux divided by the current, strictly speaking, applies only for DC case or the static case. Under the high frequency considerations, the difference between these two will be different. Okay? And of course, those differences actually depend on the material or the geometry of the material as well. Because if you plot the inductance, okay, of at high frequency divided that inductance by the DC value of the inductance, which I denote by L0, as a function of A by delta, where A is the radius and delta of course is the skin depth. So you can show that at very low values of A by delta, that is when the area is quite small, the delta is quite large, right? Or area is small and delta is quite large. So the skin depth is essentially occupying the entire area A. Okay? You might have the skin depth of 1 millimeter, but if I consider the radius of the wire also as about half a millimeter, then delta is larger than A. Okay? So in that case, the inductance that you obtain will be something, and as A starts to increase, this fellow starts to decrease. Okay? However, if you go to the straight approximation, which is called as the Rayleigh approximation, okay, under the Rayleigh approximation, you do not worry about all this. You just take this one to be the delta into W kind of a thing. We have not discussed, we don't want to discuss that one right now. It's a little complicated. Not complicated, it will take a little bit of a time. So this approximation is called as the Rayleigh approximation, which simply assumes that the entire current flows in the skin depth delta. Okay? For that approximation will be different from the exact analysis that you have obtained. And these two analyses eventually start to become, you know, close to each other when A becomes much larger than delta. Okay? So we have shown you by quasi-static analysis of skin depth how to calculate the complex surface impedance of a wire. So next time when you operate or when you use a wire or a coaxial cable, please remember that that has a certain impedance which keeps changing as the frequency changes. Thank you very much.